do you force 100,000 people out of their homes without facing major resistance? Even if you're the United States government, facing down what's being peddled as the greatest threat our nation has ever faced, the answer is, you don't. This is Frequency File, Episode 3, The Human Cost. Last episode, I reported all the cold, hard facts I could get my hands on. If you missed that episode, here's the summary. There wasn't much. Now, we jump tracks to the stories of the people, to knit together old records and eyewitness accounts to form some fabric of the true story. Whoever's job it was at ARDA to suppress stories did a really good job. What they did to keep that sheer number of people from talking, and then to smear the stories that did come out, was a masterstroke of obfuscation. Unfortunately for ARDA, the cases that made it all the way to court became public record. And the facts were these. ARDA played nice at first with a generous relocation package. They offered cold, hard cash and built sprawling housing complexes in nearly every state to resettle the former residents. These new communities were built as idyllic, white picket-fenced neighborhoods where you were sure to be surrounded by all-American families who shared your same values while enjoying the benefits of government-subsidized grocery stores, school districts, and manicured public parks. Not a bad deal from the looks of things. When it came to the holdouts, the people who wouldn't leave for any amount, things got ugly. But in the end, the government won out, as it always does. And while the government has the sovereign right to seize private property, the Fifth Amendment mandates just compensation be paid for it. But it doesn't specify when or how this compensation be made, and many dissenters ended up with nothing through good old loopholes and bureaucracy. Some of whom are still pursuing their claims to this day. But the chilling thing is, those left with empty pockets consider themselves lucky. There is a saying they mutter amongst themselves under their breath, that at least they had the luck to not live in Sierra.
Are you ready, driver? Okay, first off, I've loaded up three locations on your ARC device map. You see them? Head to whichever strikes your fancy.
You're sending them to the Visions?
Sure am. We're gonna use this.
My optical vasilizer. We shouldn't use that.
Why not?
I mean, it's been decades. No way that thing is in any sort of working shape.
I've been fixing her up in secret, and I'm sorry. Don't be mad. It's gonna be a surprise for your birthday. Oh, I've gone ahead and made an itty-bitty modification to your headset, Triver. I've hooked up the basilizer here to modulate your scan function. Think of it like an extra layer of mayonnaise on your technology sandwich.
What are you using the basilizer for?
No spoilers. We have to tell the story from the beginning. Driver, get ready to feast your eyes on the Visions. So we told you about the mass hallucination. Hundreds of people, 30 seconds of crazy, yada yada. But there was one instance where that event and the remnants intersected. The story of Laura Cesari. Laura worked at ARTA as an executive secretary. She put in her hours, but she spent her evenings with a real passion. Painting. When the hallucination event swept through, Laura was overtaken like everyone else. But for her, the Visions didn't stop. She tried painting them, but grew frustrated at her inability to recreate what she saw. Now at first, Otto wrote her off as one of the many whose brains got scrambled by what they saw, until Laura stumbled across a rusty can of paint in the woods. It was a remnant. Once she started using this paint, the visions in her paintings began to come true. She painted feverishly for over a year, chasing the visions the entire time. until the day the paint ran empty.
And then she disappeared, like all remnant holders do.
Now that we know the remnants and the mass hallucination are related, maybe Laura's visions can help us out. This is where your theory comes in, Francis. You tell him. Look at me babbling away. Francis, you explain it. It's so good.
No, it's just... I'd rather not.
Hey, come on. We talked about this. You should be proud of your work. Toot your own horn.
Not this time.
Okay, well, Francis's theory, his entire branch of research was that the zone exhibits a property seen nowhere else on Earth. Every phenomena that occurs here leaves its fingerprint forever on the physical space. So he created this device to pick up on these sub-physical after effects. How did you explain it? It was like identifying a whale's favorite color using only the wake it leaves behind. The rest was science mumbo-jumbo.
It's a form of electromagnetic imprint. Anyway, it was a long time ago.
And what a better time than now to try it again! Hey, is it just me, or did this mirror look different before?
Probably the instability messing with the paint over time. It's been decades, after all.
Nah, something's definitely off. Hey, where's our old notes from when we took a field trip out that way? Driver, why don't you go ahead to the next one while we investigate this? I can't even look at it. Francis, you explain it.
And maybe you've already seen them, driver. A freestanding bright blue door in its frame, out in the wilderness with nothing around it. If you do see one, don't get anywhere close to it.
I don't want to talk about it.
He was pretty close to a doorway when it opened. It's called the inverting doorway. When the door is shut, it's safe. But once in a while, it opens, and everything near it is turned inside out. Its victims are mostly bears, squirrels, and birds. They all go through hell. Meat and bones on the outside, fur and feathers on the inside. It's not fun to see. Once, a group of hikers didn't heed the warning, and...
No, we're done here, driver. If you see one, you stay away from it. That's all you need to know. Let's go.
Thank you.
The great pile-up. You know, if you catch the mural at the right angle, when the moon is right overhead, you can spot the helmsman's body in one of the boats.
No chance. It's a paint smudge, nothing more.
Believe me, it's true. I've seen it.
Oh, did you see that, Francis? Oh, boy, Francis, look. Look here. It's different from our sketch when we visited in 82.
It's all scrambled, but the shape seems familiar. If you tilt your head, doesn't that kind of look like Mount Olympus?
Oh, Francis, you flippin' genius! It absolutely is! Wait, let's look back at the first one. What's different there?
That shape right there, is that Hook Valley?
Holy smokes! Oh, wait, pull up all the topographical maps of the peninsula. If we look around the areas where you'd get that view of Mount Olympus... See, Francis? I told you your basilizer would work!
I don't think this is the basilizer's doing.
Driver, we're on to something. Get to that third vision.
No, I'm telling you, the helmsman never made it out of the zone. He died here.
Not this again. I still don't know why you're so convinced he existed in the first place.
Driver, back me up here. This is how the story goes. It was the winter of 72. A ship set sail down the Columbia River 100 miles east of here. The helmsman was overcome by bad weather, and while in a particularly foggy patch, the boat hit something, and the impact threw him from the deck. When he woke up, he was on a boat on this very lake, smack in the middle of the zone, with no idea how he got there. He had with him a ridiculous amount of cash and paid anyone and everyone to get him out of the zone. But no matter how he tried to leave, on foot, in a transport, he would always head into a fog and reemerge on another boat. At last count, the great pileup was 20 boats high and 30 boats wide.
A limb duplication glitch, nothing more.
And you, of all people, blaming limb tech instead of a good old-fashioned mystery?
It doesn't add up. Artist's favorite pastime was carting people out of the zone. How could someone actually fail to escape? And a mysterious man with a backpack full of cash, and the one place he can't spend it. Seems awfully fishy to me.
So about that last vision.
Driver, if you come across a mushroom like the one in the mural, do not eat it. No matter how tasty it might look.
You're speaking from personal experience. And let me tell you, it wasn't pretty.
Oh, just thinking about it makes me want to puke all over again. You've probably passed the biogenerators by now. They're our source of power in the mid-zone, and one of the best demonstrations of renewable limb tech. Yes, these battery farms keep our lights on, but more importantly, they're also the only place in the entire zone where anomalized mushrooms grow.
And guess who turned out to be the world's biggest fan of those mushrooms? Bigfoot itself! And the vision foretold its arrival in the zone!
It started when those pods hanging from the battery farms were found chewed up. At first, they blamed it on the local wildlife. This was back when we used to have some.
Then, the sightings of 10-foot-tall creatures started. That didn't attract much attention on their own.
Not until the first footprints were found. The Olympic Peninsula has always had a collection of Bigfoot sightings, but they were rare until Bigfoot had its first taste of the anomalized mushrooms. Then it couldn't stay away. And that's when the squatches came knocking. They jumped the wall, set up camp, and they got to investigating. Once they learned of the Sasquatch's appetite for these mushrooms, they cultivated entire farms of the stuff.
For months, they propagated mushrooms and set traps. And for months, evidence mounted that Sasquatch was making its rounds and evading those traps. Until one night, the experts disappeared.
Bigfoot got them, no question.
Come on, all eight at once? How is that possible?
Never get in the way of a hungry Sasquatch.
Bigfoot mural. My personal favorite. Bingo!
See that pattern in the last mural? That flower only grows above a certain elevation. Put the three locations together, and you've got a square mile in the northeast corner of the deep zone. Huh. The visions were pointing towards something the entire time.
Hey, Oppy. You can stop pretending to ignore us now. Take a look at this fine work. We've pinned down the location for the source of the mass hallucination. That's where the driver needs to go.
Well, what do you know?
Well, I knew the basilizer worked. What did I tell you, huh?
He still doesn't know, Francis.
Know what? Oppie?
Not my story to share.
My theory. And that basilizer, they're, illegitimate.
Wait, what are you saying?
I built that device to prove my imprint theory, and it was on the verge of getting the results I needed. But my research funding was running out. So, I forged the data. Not much, just enough to justify more time. I was so close, I knew the breakthrough was right around the corner. But Arda found out. That's why I was reassigned and my clearance revoked.
Wait, you told me you changed labs voluntarily.
8 years of research with nothing to show for it, and then for that to happen, I couldn't face you.
That doesn't mean your theory is wrong.
I still think there's something to it. There's a common thread with some of the remnant stories, like the telephone switchboard, the ones that seem to recall the past somehow. Maybe the remnants access those imprints, read them like a needle in the groove of a record.
Don't. You don't have to do that. It's in the past. I don't care about it anymore.
But listen, I've got this suspicion, right?
If we can just get the car to the mass hallucination source, what we find they can prove your theory. It's worth a try, isn't it?
I'm tired of trying, Tobias. I've tried all my life, and it didn't go so well.
Look, I don't have one of those fancy degrees that you and Oppie have. The closest I ever got to science was wiping down your lab benches. But I saw the incredible things that you did with your research.
Yeah, well, Arda didn't think they were incredible.
I don't care about Arda. I believe in you. Always have.
I'm sorry. I can't. I can't do this with her. Oppie led the disciplinary committee that stripped my clearance and demoted me to a glorified intern. She sat there and decided how best to humiliate me. I never asked for anything. This one time I do, so I would never have to talk to Oppie again. You didn't listen. Your remnant was more important than what I wanted.
Francis, I didn't mean...
I've had enough.
He'll come around. Sorry, driver. We'll see you back at the auto shop.
Interesting thing about that deep zone area you identified. I ran every coordinate in that area through the Otter database, and what turns up? But access logs, with entry records for Dr. K up through March 1963.
What? No, the doctor died in 1961, and then the lab accident.
So we were told. Then, I found access logs for both that deep zone site and Red Meadow. Years and years worth of activity.
The Red Meadow Research Facility? But it was demolished the same year. After the structural damage caused by the... They lied about that too, didn't they?
It appears so. The driver should give the Red Meadow ruins a visit. If Dr. K didn't die that day, I'd like to know what was keeping him so busy.
So would I, but... Do we have time for this? We don't know how long the driver's got with that remnant.
And that's why we need this information. Whatever Dr. K was doing relates to all of this. It may be the key to what lies at the end of the road for the driver.
I agree with you. God, I hate saying that.
Driver, I've marked the Red Meadow facility on your route planner. Head there whenever you're ready.